Okay, verse 17, the covenant makers pass through the animal pieces, and guess who? Abram, he's put to sleep, right? Mm-hmm. So who is passing through those pieces? Alone? God. It, Abram's covenant is unconditional. It's unilateral. God recites the terms of the covenant. When you're walking through the figure eight, you're reciting the terms of the covenant, like we, what we talked about, and the blessings and the cursings. And the boundaries of the land are given to Abraham. I mean, point blank, there's no question. He doesn't have to do anything to get it. He just has to be Abraham. And then it goes to his seed, which ultimately goes to Christ, because Christ comes from his seed, and he's the king, and he has to have a kingdom. So that's why he's given the land. Just an insight here, blood has to be shed when a covenant is made. You can see in Hebrews 9:19 that there's blood of slain calves and goats. You can see in Hebrews 9:20 that blood that seals and ratifies the agreement. Hebrews 9:21-22, he's sprinkled with the blood. And then without the shedding of blood, there is neither release from sin and its guilt, nor the remission of the due and merited punishment for sin. So there has to be bloodshed when there's a covenant. Okay, so Genesis 15:13-16, we're back on. God said to Abram, know for certain that your descendants will be... This is what he's saying while Abram's asleep, okay? Know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, where they will be enslaved and oppressed for 400 years. But I will also judge the nation whom they will serve, and afterward they will come out with many possessions. As for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace, and you will be buried at a good old age. Then in the fourth generation, they will return here, for the iniquity of the Amorite is not yet complete. Huh, let's look at that right there. God loves the Amorites. God loves everybody that he creates. But these people have joined with the Nephilim. These are the ones that have allowed them... Let me tell you how it happens. A devil, actually in the spirit realm, sits on your shoulder and starts talking to you. And then when you start agreeing with him, then he can come into you. Did y'all know that? So, you have to have agreement with him. They can't attack you and say, I'm coming in. No, you have a will. We talked about this. You have a will, and you have to make a will. I mean, you have to make a decision to serve God or to serve Satan. Okay, or serve man. We talked about the fact that God put enmity between God and man. So there's actually three wills on the earth. Okay, but these people God loves, but they've been given over to debauchery. I mean, really, really bad stuff. And so God's giving them, look at this, you don't miss this. God's giving them every possible chance to repent, to come back to him. Because they are his people, but they're given over to evil. He says their sin is not yet full. Remember we talked about the fact that when you rob a bank, when you're poor, and you rob a bank because you need the money or whatever, and you kind of had a good upbringing or whatever, and you kind of feel bad when you rob the bank, but when you get down to the end of the money, you go rob it again. This time you don't feel as bad. Well, what's happening is the iniquity is becoming full. That's how Lucifer fell. It started out small, and then he didn't repent. And then as he continued to not repent and continued to do it, his iniquity became full, and now he can never be redeemed because his iniquity is full. Well, guys, did you think about this? America is 233 years old. Earlier civilizations have only lasted about two centuries. So we're 33 years over that. You know, our time is pretty much up. But the point is that I think God is saying this to us. Is our iniquity full? I mean, we talked about the fact that his glory is coming. When our iniquity... He gives you a time period. He gives you time to put the rope around your own neck, you know, and that's what's happening, is people are just thumbing their nose up at God and saying, you don't exist, but the reason why they're doing that is because God hadn't shown himself yet. I mean, it is very, very common for people to do that because I haven't seen him. I mean, in 1950s was the last time that God made a move across this land. I wasn't born. So therefore, you know, my generation, the ones that, whatever, they thumb their nose at the God and say, you don't exist, I'm going to do whatever I want to. But when he shows up, you'll see. So Romans 2:4-11, or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repent? But because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who will render to each person according to his deeds. To those who by perseverance in doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life, but to those who are selfishly ambitious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, wrath, and indignation, there will be tribulation and distress for every soul of man who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek, but glory and honor and peace to everyone who does good. Did y'all know that there is a repercussion for a country to thumb their nose up at God? Did y'all know that there's actually a judgment that God puts on a country? What's that judgment? It's a specific judgment. If you read Romans 1, you'll find it. Homosexuality. Homosexuality is a judgment that God places. He gives you over. It's not that God makes you homosexual, but that is the repercussions of a society that's gone wild. And it actually says that he gives you over to that type of lifestyle. A new guy coming in today, and he was homosexual, and I shared my testimony. Just a little. You know, I didn't say much, but he was telling me how he has a degree and all that, and he's an office manager, and he can't find a job. And I told him how God's taking care of me. And I work less hours and still make the same amount of money because I trust him. If you trust the state or the government or whatever, it's going to fall. And so you have to be in the situation today where you trust God to take care of you, because Hebrews 12:25-27 says he is shaking everything so that only what is of him will remain. You think about that. Everything. He's shaking everything. And if you're not on the rock, you're going to fall. Everything that the foundation is, when you think you've built, that's why he told me when, you know, some have heard this, but he said to me, he said, do I own the shop? And I said, Lord, you know you own the shop. I thought, you know, ever since my husband was killed by a shark, I talk about him all the time. I talk about God to everybody. I try some way to talk about God. The next day, I went from 15 clients a day to one. I was like, whoa, that was a weird day. And I go home and I come back and one again. And I'm like, okay, what's going on here? I quickly learned that I didn't own this shop. God owns this shop. Or I could have made a choice. At the same time, I was offered the best job offer I've ever had in my life. I was to replace the vocational center's cosmetology teacher. $50,000 plus benefits and insurance and all that. And God said to me, he goes, do you really think that's me? That will not give you any time with me. And I'm looking at the job going, oh, but look at the situation here. And he's like, that's not me. And so I made a choice to stay here and not have many people. So what I did was I ran into the Bible. This was 2 years ago. I mean, really got into the Bible. I was in the Bible before. But when I'm not busy, if you come in here, you will find my face in this computer studying the Word of God, because I want the foundation to be solid. If anything is built with me on it, this place is going to crumble. I don't want that to happen. I depend on this shop. Had a guy come in here last week, and he was going to commit suicide. No doubt in my mind, his wife left him. His wife was telling his kids that he molested them when they were a child, which was not true. All kinds of bad stuff just happened to this poor guy. And I've been doing his hair forever. And he said, I don't know why I'm here. He said, I don't really need a haircut. He said, but I just need help. And he just started bawling. And so God has placed this place where people know that this is a place to come to. Is that my foundation or his foundation? It's his foundation. And I know that now. But I chose wisdom rather than riches. And because I did that, I am secure.